Ideally, I should not be teaching family law and criminal law, because I never taught family law. Aligarh people never trusted me with teaching of Muslim law or Hindu law, even though they gave me all kinds of subjects. They were worried what kind of interpretation I may give of Muslim law, which may not be good music to at least some of the conservative elements. And I left criminal law teaching decades ago, when constitutional law was forced on me, as a number of teachers retired and few died and few went out of country. So there was nobody and I was the junior most. That's how I got it. But this year is a peculiar year, and therefore myself and Professor Dhanda, we thought it fit that at least our first year students should get some sense of what is happening on the front of family law and on the front of criminal law. And that's why I will be talking to you on criminal law and on family law. Now, my opposition to criminalization of triple divorce is not confined just to one civil law matter on which I am saying don't use criminal law. It goes to adultery, it goes to 377, and it goes to number of criminal statutes which we every other day are enacting in different state capitals and also in parliament. So 2 days ago, a circular was issued in Uttar Pradesh. Very interesting. If you want to make something a crime, ideally you should use legislature. But the circular says if any religious place or a wedding function uses loudspeaker without permission, then they will be punished with imprisonment of 3 years or 5 years, whatever, something like that. And my problem is, even when someone dies, if you look at the policy of Indian Penal Code, when someone is dead, rash and negligent driving leading to the death of a human being, the punishment is only 2 years. Similarly, on divorce bill, you, as you know, as passed by Lok Sabha, the punishment is 3 years. Therefore, there is no parity in fixing the punishment. And it is not that X government or Y government does it. We have been doing it for last 25 years. India is increasingly becoming an example of over-criminalization. And therefore, we need to go back to the first principles of criminal law. What are the classical principles of criminal law? What misconduct becomes a crime? What are the constituent of a crime? Because another trend is that we are increasingly punishing people under strict liability crimes, where we do not look at the mental element. This again, in my opinion, is a very, very regressive step. Even though I don't believe in this, and I am going to demonstrate to you in the criminal law class. But there are theorists who say that the primitive criminal law started with strict liability. One, I can challenge even this assumption. This hypothesis itself, in my opinion, is wrong. But assuming for the sake of argument that it is true, should our modern progressive criminal law go back to the primitive criminal law? And that is why I oppose the strict liability crimes. Since our prosecution is not able to prove crimes, let us take away the rights of the accused. This has been the trend for the last 25, 35 years in India. And therefore, there is no blame on the present government. This is how we have been reacting to situations. The easiest thing is to sit in parliament, pass a law. And that's why we are going to look at rights of the accused as shifting of the burden of proof. And appreciate the significance and the value of the first principles. So my task with you in criminal law is to tell you that first principles continue to remain relevant for any good, modern, progressive criminal justice system. In family law debates, in fact on all issues for that matter, be it a family law or a criminal law or a constitutional law, the real blame is not with X ideology or Y government or X organization or Y organization. The real culprit is our media, which you will know in a class of today. Because I believe at least my students at NALSAR should not be guided by this 30 minutes at the very high volume discussion at number of TV channels where no informed debate really takes place. It cannot take place. This is also true. In half an hour, you cannot have an informed debate. If, say, on a TV channel, you have to get the victim of a triple divorce, you have to get an activist, you have to get an academic, you have to get a lawyer, each one will get 2-3 minutes. No real discussion can take place. And therefore, in family law, like in several other areas, we continue to have so many myths. We don't meet the empirical evidence. So one major myth which we have and on which I want to talk today, we think all religious laws are bad and all state laws are good. This is the hypothesis. So when a state makes a law, it must be making great law. Therefore, try to understand my opposition to this bill is not new. I was not happy even with the so-called Nirbhaya Act either. I thought that that was a wrong solution to the problem. By giving very wide definitions of crime, and you know, now you have 3-4 years, you have seen, it has not brought down the violence against women. It has not brought down the rate of rapes. So this is one major myth. I'm not denying that religions are old. And since they are old, there may be a number of regressive provisions in each religious system. I myself may not be a very, very religious person. But those who believe, it is their problem. Let them believe. They are entitled to believe. But to think that there is no merit in the religious systems is absolutely wrong. Even Manu Smriti or say Hindu law, classical Hindu law, thinking that it gave absolutely no right to women is wrong. The British judges could not understand our system, which was a unique system with which they were not familiar. And since in their system, women could not be the owner of the property, they did not really appreciate our Hindu joint family system. By the way, I'm not defending the Koparsanavi system or Hindu joint family, but to say that women has no right under it, she can't have a property at all, was absolutely wrong idea. So my second proposition is, neither Hindu law nor Muslim law was as bad as Britishers through their interpretations have made it. In itself, law was not that bad. And I will demonstrate to you in the family law class that the rigidity in the Hindu law and in Muslim law is not inherent in law. It is a gift of the British judges. But no one blames British judges. You say, oh, Hindu law is so regressive, the Muslim law is so regressive. We never look at the contribution made by British judges to what is Muslim law today or what was Hindu law before reforms in 1955. My third proposition and a myth about which I need to talk about. Kindly switch off your mobile, they are recording. And I say it with highest amount of respect to all the religious people. After all, religions do reflect societal beliefs. Therefore, if you have patriarchy in society, you can't have equality in religion. Now, this statement may be blasphemous because many consider religions as divine. They are entitled to their belief. But religious laws are not fully divine. So you have to make a distinction between religion and law. And I am not talking of religion. I am talking of law. There may be some content of divinity in law. But you have juristic opinions in law. You have judicial interpretations in law. You have legislative interventions in law. If I need to ask you what is Hindu law, you can't say it is entirely divine. Some portion of Hindu law is uncodified, based on classical principles. Some part of it has been incorporated in the legislations, Hindu Marriage Act, Hindu Succession Act, this and that. Some has been excluded. And of course, there have been interpretations. And since religions are old, is it fair to look at them with a glass of Indian Constitution and Article 14? There was a very interesting case decided by Delhi High Court. It was about that provision with which I have a problem. Restitution of conjugal rights. Say one spouse has left the matrimonial home because he or she is not happy. But our law says, Section 9 of the Hindu Marriage Act, and similar law is there in other family law systems as well. So if my wife is unhappy with me and she has gone to, as I said, main meh ke chali jaungi kind of thing, I can go to the court of law and get her back. In number of Muslim countries even today, the wife has a duty to obey husband. And that is my precise problem with the new bill, because government is making a law borrowing from Muslim countries. They are not a great example to follow. There are laws, their laws are not progressive. They are not based on gender justice. And therefore, if you want to borrow a law in the name of gender justice from Muslim countries, I have a problem as a student of constitutional law. Because those countries are not a model for me. Get my point? So I can force her through the court, come back. I think it compromises individual choice. If she wants to go, let her go. So there was a case on this, and the Delhi High Court said bringing constitutional law in family matters is like a bull in a china shop. So I feel it is grossly unfair to test religious laws on the touchstone of our constitution or modern laws. What we should ideally see for any religious law, when it originated, what was the law prior to it? Was it an improvement on an earlier law at that point of time? See, if you need to look at Christianity, you have to see, is an improvement on Judaism? Is it an improvement on Hindu law? When you need to look at Islam, you have to see what was pre-Islamic Arabian law. Did it make a departure from that? And allow me to say, it makes such a marked departure that at one point of time, the Prophet has said the wife can also give a slap to the husband. But then interpretation, then jurist, they so interpreted the text and the scriptures that the patriarchy was back with a vengeance. And whatever little gains were made, they were undermined. And that has been the story of most family laws. So to give you a very brief description, we have a female infanticide even today, though the law prohibits it. Even though now we do not permit determination of the sex of the fetus. And if you go to all this ultrasound clinics, you will have one that warning written, we will not tell. Still they tell. You have to just give them more money. And who get this fetus aborted? Illiterate people. Poor people. Where is the money for them to get an ultrasound done? We, elite. Rich people. Educated people. And look at the adverse sex ratio. The situation is so bad that in Haryana and Punjab, people are going to Jharkhand and other because there are no women available there. In some families, brothers are sharing the wife. Where are we going? And we are discussing triple divorce. Because our priorities are not set and intentions are not honest. So at that point of time, prior to advent of Islam, in fact, advent word itself is wrong. As I said that in both criminal law class and family law class, my primary job in this semester is to clarify the myths. So it is again a myth that Islam started with Prophet Muhammad. It was not a new religion. It was not started by him. According to Islamic belief, it started with Adam. And you cannot be a Muslim if you do not believe in Adam as a prophet of God. And you cannot be a Muslim if you don't believe in Jesus or in Moses or in all the prophets. And very few are mentioned. Most are not mentioned. And that was the success story of Islam, that it was not a departure. It was continuity of the religious tradition that God has spoken to man through certain prophets. But still, the kind of revolution he made, if a baby girl is born, the father will take her and bury her alive. In my opinion, going to ultrasound clinics and getting the fetus aborted is burying her alive. And do this homework today. To look at the numbers. And compare this number, if you want, with triple divorce incidents. And look at the amount of time we spend on national TV and in print media on triple divorce and how much time we spend on female infanticide. We don't even allow her to come in this world and we talk of gender justice. I have still yet to come across a mother-in-law telling daughter-in-law, beti ho, aisa aashirwaad dete hue maine kisi ko nahi dekha. Jab saasein aur daadiyein aur pardaadiyein aashirwaad deti hain, to woh kehti hai, beta, jaan sa. Even in mosques, when on Friday Imam will pray, to do karte aulade nari na ho, jo be aulade hain unko aulade nari na ho. Narina means in Arabic male child. Hum to nahi dete dua abhi tak ki beti ho. What
claim we have for gender justice. So when the Prophet said that anyone, when a daughter is born, then my blessings comes to that family. And any father who takes good care of two daughters will be this close to me in heaven. It was a revolution. There was unlimited polygamy, as you know. So the father will have any number of wives. So there will be for everybody several stepmothers. When the father will die, the sons will inherit stepmothers. And therefore, when Prophet said, you cannot marry anybody whom your father, grandfather, great-grandfather, great-great-grandfather has married. It was a revolution. There was no choice for her in marriage. Making her competent to decide whom she wants to marry. Out of independent choice. We still don't give. Khab panchayat deti hai. If I fall in love with a girl of my own village, I can't marry. Still parents decide. In many cases, in joint families, not even parent, Darji decides. And how did we interpret? That's why I'm saying that the patriarchy strikes back, and we are not doing anything to address patriarchy. So Prophet gave this choice to her, and how we interpret it. You know, there are various schools. We will talk about those schools. So under certain schools, it is the father which gives the daughter in marriage. Of course, the consent is required. But the ceremony is like father giving. What is kanyadan? I have a problem with word daan. Daan does not reflect a human being who is an independent. It commoditizes women. She is something which is given and which is taken. As I said, it is a myth that all state laws are gender just. This is the law made by the state that kanyadan takes place. Therefore, the myth of the divinity of laws. In my opinion, in family laws, scriptures are sources of law. You have to derive a law from them. You have to infer law from them. In finding out law from scriptures, because we are interpreting, we are men, we are patriarchal, we will make rules which go against us. We are not idiots. And therefore, whatever little gains you will make in a religious tradition through interpretation, it will go. It will disappear. Societal customs will come back. How important are customs? I give you one example. Even under international law is law of nations. Of course, many say it is lawless law of nations. If you look at Article 38 of the Statute of International Court of Justice, now customs comes at number two. But when we had League of Nations and Permanent Court of International Justice, custom was the first source of law. Practices of states. Even reformed Hindu law has not completely nullified all customs. And therefore, even with Hindu Marriage Act, number of customs continue to govern us. And therefore, this third myth, which I want to demolish today, we think Hindu law has been reformed. Great. Yes, some progress has been made, but not completely reformed. Still, it is possible for a Hindu to take birth and die without interacting with state-enacted law called Hindu Code Bill. I can marry as per my customs. I can also divorce as per my customs. We will have some occasion to talk of number of interesting kinds of divorces which we have in tribal community. You throw a stone on me and I throw a stone on you and marriage is broken. Yes, this is the custom. Hindu law itself makes rooms for customs. And finally, before I go to take my first myth, are we really fully convinced and aware and absolutely clear who is a Hindu and who is a Muslim? On the triple divorce bill itself, if you were following Lok Sabha debates, Akali Dal, which is part of NDA, you must go today, this is your homework, and listen to a speech of Akali Dal MP on triple divorce bill. He said nothing on triple divorce bill. His grievance is, how come in Article 25 of Indian Constitution and all of course under the Hindu Marriage Act, word Hindu includes a Sikh? How come you apply your law on me? How do you say that Sikhs are also Hindus? Similar protests are made by Jains. It's indeed very, very difficult to decide who is a Hindu. Because unlike other monotheist religions, which have one book and prophets and law and this and that, Hindu law has number of gods, number of books. It's very difficult to decide even the core. And that is the beauty of Hindu law. That is the beauty of Hindu religion. The diversity. Another myth with which the British judges and British government suffered in India, they thought Hindus are one homogeneous community and Muslims are another homogeneous community. This again is a myth. One type of Hindu is different from another type of Hindu, as one type of a Muslim is different from another type of Muslim. So diversity within religions. British could not understand and could not appreciate. And don't think it is easy for Muslims to decide who is a Muslim either. You had a whole Munir Commission in Pakistan to decide who is a Muslim. Are Ahmadiyyas are Muslims? Indian courts have taken the view that since to become a Muslim, you have to just say La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, which means there is no God but one. Many believe in one God, including Hindus. Brahma is one. And Prophet Muhammad is the prophet of God. That's it. And therefore Madras High Court said that the finality of believing that Prophet Muhammad is the last prophet is not necessary to be a Muslim. And therefore Qadianis are also Muslims. And the controversy goes on and on. Most Muslims think they are not, because it is the core. And there is evidence in Quran about the finality of the prophethood. So whatever be the theological argument, legally Indian courts decisions, Pakistan courts decisions vary on a fundamental question: who is a Muslim? Therefore, we must appreciate the context. Irfan, can I move? The point I am trying to make, that just like all religions on all aspects are not anti-women, similarly, all customs are not necessarily anti-women. My second statement is, believing that a state alone should have the monopoly of lawmaking is also wrong. Legal pluralism accepts, admits, acknowledges there are non-state sources of law. So much so that even the courts are not the only forum of adjudication of disputes. Most disputes don't reach courts. And the example I am giving is from United States, where a survey was done about 1,000 corporates. And most of them were getting their dispute resolved through arbitration. In fact, in England, now it is an acknowledged fact that the civil justice system is dying. It is dying because it is failing. You must have heard me and you must have read some of my write-ups. Why I'm saying revive your civil law. Use your civil law. Over-reliance on criminal law is not good. You don't decide cases for years. Your litigation is costly. So people settle disputes outside your civil system. In criminal justice system, they don't have a choice. So you are imposing on them, forcing them. This will create additional load. If you create new crimes, there will be additional load. Few years back, just one small amendment we made in the Negotiable Instrument Act on the bouncing of checks. And we were flooded with lakhs and lakhs of cases. Where these cases are filed? In the state forums. Lower courts are under the control of the state government. So they need more judges, more prosecutors, more investigators, more jails. Where is the cost-benefit analysis? We are blindly and indiscriminately enacting laws, making laws, without doing any legislative impact analysis. Most of these laws we pass in Parliament without any financial memorandum. And the state don't have resources. I have seen number of courts in India do not have electricity. In Northeast, I have seen number of judges don't get even bear it. And we want them to dispense justice. Many of you, if you are taken to lower courts, will be so turned off. You will never practice in lower court where the real action is taking place. We are putting additional burden on our lower courts. Already the judge population ratio is adverse. But this issue will never be discussed at Times Now or Republic or any other TV channel. And that's why media is killing intellectual debate in this country. So this tendency to project all customary law as anti-women and all state-enacted law as pro-women, it is wrong. The history of women's rights is not linear with the scriptures and customary laws framing one end of the scale and statutory reforms at the instance of the state slowly and steadily progressing towards the other. History is complex. And various interactive forces constantly are at play. And therefore, I believe we must look at it that in spite of codification, in spite of reforms, large segment of Hindu law and large segment of Hindu population lives and manages its affairs outside the state law and outside the regulations of the state law. As I said earlier, a Hindu need not interact with the state authorities, neither for solemnization of marriage, neither for its dissolution, as these can be easily carried away and carried out under customary practices. The other point I want to make is state courts are necessarily not the best forum. The formal court structure is alien to women. There again, there is a domination of men. Even in rape trials, you have seen the kind of cross-examinations which have taken place. You feel like hanging yourself in shame. Until recently, you had laws that if she was not chaste, if she was a woman of easy virtue, that means she consented. This is nonsense. So now let us look at Hindu law for today. We will look at non-state Hindu law to begin with. Dharma Shastras or the Brahminical Smriti law, in my opinion, is not law in the strict sense. Dharma Shastras contain principles. A principle and a norm are different. Last time we discussed, I taught you, legal method. What is a law? What is law with capital L? What is law with a small l? What is laws? What is the law? Bataya tha na? So Dharma Shastras contain principles. From principles, laws are derived. Number of conservative Muslims condemn me for this, because I have also said that Quran is also not book of law. It is book of principles. It is source of inspiration. In the triple divorce debate, those who are opposing it, those who are favoring it, in my opinion, both are wrong. Because those who are saying, oh, Quran lays down this law, they treat word of Quran as law. As Arif Muhammad Khan has written yesterday, for instance, several others. Those who are opposing it are also wrong. Because after all, it is based on juristic opinion, which can be reviewed. Jurists are humans, they are not divine. If something is divine, there may be resistance for change. But if it is human, you can sit, have an argument, decide. Some change here, some change there, possible. So Dharma Shastras don't contain law in the strict sense. They talk of principles. And Smritis, preached and promoted dharma. What is dharma? This religion is a very problematic thing. There shall be no lasting peace in the world till there is peace between and within religion. Religions are so important for human beings. And they keep fighting and shedding blood. Dharma, what is dharma? Denoting ethics, morality, and good behavior. Good behavior is sadachar. Law kahan aaya isme? Where is law? Dharma denoting ethics. Ethics are not law.
अरे यही तो मेरी लड़ाई है यार ट्रिपल डिवोर्स पे. Ulema are saying triple divorce is sin. Government is also saying sin. And you are criminalizing a sin. Sin is the domain of morality. It is not the domain of law. Sin has to do with theology, not with law. Nobody is appreciating this argument. It is common sense. Dominate or lelo? Customs. Dharmashastras and then customs. Very important source of law. अब आपको मैं law बता रहा हूं. Law बता रहा हूं. ये settled law है. If custom contravenes smritis, जो religious हैं, which one will prevail? तो रिलीजन कहां हुआ? व्हाट अबाउट कस्टम कंट्रावीनिंग लेजिस्लेशन? प्रीवी काउंसिल का जजमेंट है, नाम लिखिए. यार बोर्ड यहां रखो. इट्स अ प्रीवी काउंसिल जजमेंट. मुतलिंगा समथिंग एम्परर. आई विल गिव यू द साइटेशन. क्लियर प्रूफ ऑफ कस्टम. दिस वॉज द रेशियो. क्लियर प्रूफ ऑफ कस्टम आउटवेज अ रिटन टेक्स्ट. एक स्टेप और ले जाते हैं आपके मिथ को खत्म करने के लिए. स्मृति क्या है? यू नो वी मेक अ डिफरेंस बिटवीन श्रुति एंड स्मृति. श्रुति तो चलिए डिवाइन मान ली जाए. स्मृति क्या है? कस्टम्स रिकॉर्डेड बाय मनु और अदर्स. श्रुतिज में लॉ नहीं होता इतना, प्रिंसिपल्स होते हैं. स्मृतिज में लॉ होता है. And smritis were recording of accepted local custom. So Manu Smriti, kal Jignesh Mavani was presenting to Prime Minister, you have a constitution and a Manu Smriti, pick up one. Kya hai Manu Smriti? It's not divine code of law. It's recording of local customs by Manu. And ye bhi nahi malum hai asli wale kaun Manu hai, kai Manu the. So smritis were recording of accepted local customs. And local customs were Brahminical. आगे ब्राह्मण. सो मच सो दैट इट वॉज दैट ब्राह्मणिकल दैट शूद्रास आर आउटसाइड द स्मृति. इट इज नॉट एप्लीकेबल ऑन देम बिकॉज वी डोंट कंसीडर देम एज फुल सिटीजन्स. बट कैन यू ब्लेम फॉर दिस हिंदू लॉ और हिंदू रिलीजन और हिंदू गॉड्स? No, our customs, our patriarchy was recorded. It became Manu Smriti. And therefore the problem is in customs. If problem is in customs, law cannot easily negate customs. Child marriage is a custom. Looking down at a female child is a mindset product of our customs. Dowry is a custom. And dowry prohibition law has not succeeded. And therefore, if you want to bring about a change in the society, you can't do it overnight by some law. Law is not a great agent of social change. You have to do more. My grievance is, we don't do more. We just feel satisfied we have passed the law. Okay? Any question? Comment? Criticism? We shall continue.